In this episode of Swift News, we're talking about what's new in UIKit. Remember that? How to improve your menus for iPadOS, macOS, and iOS. Some tips to improve your App Store screenshots. Server-side Swift. Being addicted to agentic coding. And a new app from former Swift UI team members. As always, links to everything you see here will be in the Swift News GitHub repo. The link to that repo is in the description. And you can sign up for the Swift News newsletter if you want to get Swift News directly to your email inbox. First up, we have What's New in UIKit by Seb Vidal, and it is a 64-minute read. So obviously, I'm not going to summarize everything. I'll highlight some key points, but I want to share this because if you are building a UIKit app, which many people are, right? Swift UI is kind of taken over. That's all most people talk about. But the reality is there is so much UIKit legacy code out there that there are millions of developers still working in UIKit every day. So if you are one of those developers and you're upgrading your app to iOS 26, this is 64 minutes, well worth your time. So let's give it some highlights. First of all, I chuckled at the opening line here. WWDC is long since over, and as for recent years, UIKit is far from the star of the show. Poor UIKit. Swift UI have taken over, and Seb says, so for my fellow UIKit enjoyers out there, here's my first, maybe annual, comprehensive list. 64-minute read, very comprehensive, goes through every single change for iOS 26. So again, I'll point out some quick highlights. First up, UI app delegate. Is that getting deprecated? There were rumors circulating online about potential UI application delegate deprecation, thinking Apple would move towards a Swift UI app lifecycle. Turns out that wasn't entirely true. Some of the methods got deprecated, and they're methods that you're probably using. If you're building a UIKit app, application did become active, did enter background, will enter foreground. These are very common delegate methods that were used in UI application delegate. Probably a small syntax change, just moving over to UI scene delegate. Scene did become active. Scene did enter background. Scene will enter foreground. So probably a minor syntax change, but we are moving to this new modern scene-based delegate. So this one will probably touch almost everyone working in a UIKit app. We have UI background extension view. If you're not familiar with what this is, let me show you a picture, then you'll see it. Basically, in iOS 26 with the sidebars and liquid glass, your main image here, like this image right here, this doesn't go from side to side. Really, the image stops right here at the edge of the sidebar. What this UI background extension view here does is it extends the app's rich content, like a header image you saw down there, into the parent's unsafe areas, such as that below a UI split view controller sidebar. That's exactly what's going on down here. So like I said, the image technically stops right here at the edge of the sidebar, but what's happening with this UI background extension view, it is mirroring the image, so it's like flipping it, and then it's blurring it so that the content can shine through the liquid glass of the sidebar. And that is a running theme in this article. A lot of the new iOS 26 liquid glass stuff, like the, I guess I'm used to SwiftUI calling it the toolbar API, but UI bar button item, you get the shared background over here versus using a spacer to space them out. So the plus and minus buttons are separate buttons rather than joined here. And then the UI bar button items can get a badge. There's a new struct on UI bar button item called badge where you can adjust the foreground color, background color, string value, font, all that stuff to really make those badges nice. And then UI button, scroll down to that, gets a whole bunch more configurations. The glass, clear glass, prominent clear glass. And here you can see what that looks like. And again, this is all the typical liquid glass adoption for UIKit. And I'll highlight just like two more, because like I said, it's a 64-minute read. There is tons. Everything you need to know. Must read if you are building a UIKit app. UI Color. It's been a long time coming. Apple's display supporting HDR for many years, but UI Color has finally been updated with initializers to construct HDR colors. So that's cool. And then lastly, but definitely not least, this is very important, especially in iOS 26, and that is, we'll get there, UI Corner Configuration. So this is a new API that allows you to adjust the corner radius of a view, not just all the corners, but per corner. Here's an example with all the corners with the same corner radius, but now you can do corner configuration, dot corners, and you see top left, top right, bottom left, bottom right. So you can do those individually to get nice shapes here. More importantly, with iOS 26, you can get the concentric corners down here. See, there's a concentric view here, and then you do concentric view, dot corner configuration, dot corners, and then you do dot container concentric, and that gives you the very important concentric corners within a container in iOS 26. So again, I just touched on the surface of this article. It's a 64-minute read. So many new changes in UIKit, especially with adopting liquid glass for your app. So again, if you're working in UIKit, an absolute must read. All right, let's talk menus. Because if you're using a menu in your iPhone app, iPad app, Mac app, which you are, these next two articles are a must read to make sure you're getting the most out of your menus. So what this first article is, working with the main menu. If you've been building a Mac app with SwiftUI, this is going to be old news. But the reason I wanted to share working with this menu in SwiftUI is because, in case you didn't know, as of iOS 26, the iPad now gets this main menu across the top. So anyone with an iPad app is gonna need to know how to use the menu that we've been using on Mac apps for years now. So that's what this first article is, pretty much an introduction to using the menu, right? Using this .commands modifier, and then how you can make a command menu called task, and then it has buttons here. So you can see the task in the menu, create, edit, delete. That is the super bare bones basic, but then it goes in to show you how you can use SF symbols to add little symbols next to your menu. How you can separate menu items visually with a divider. So you get this nice little divider right here, creating submenus. See, so you have a command menu and then a menu inside that menu, and you get the submenu here, right? Priority, low, normal, high. Shows you how to assign keyboard shortcuts to the menu items. That's a simple modifier, .keyboard shortcut. And then those keyboard shortcuts will appear in your menu next to the item. So yeah, this first article, pretty basic, how to build these main menus. But like I said, it's been old news for macOS developers, but now everyone with an iPad app, which is almost everyone with an iPhone app, is gonna have to learn these command menus in SwiftUI. So definitely check this out. And Apple also has an awesome article, populating SwiftUI menus with adaptive controls. So this goes across all platforms, iPhone, iPad, macOS. And there's some similarities to the previous article that talks about just how you add the menu with SF symbols down here. Menus with SF symbols, cool, more of the same. But here you can add a subtitle, right? So you see duplicate and it tells what that does. So name and subtitle. Scrolling down, you can go even further by adding SF symbols to it. Again, similar to before. We're gonna get down to the new stuff here in a second. A lot of this is the same, but you can see button.delete, sysmembers trash, role destructive. And if you do that in your menu, well now your delete button will be red in the menu. Nice little touch there. And then it shows how to use toggles in the menu as well. So you can see here's a toggle in the menu with favorite, and then you get the little check mark as you're toggling things in the menu. And this is the one that I saw where I was like, oh, I need to implement that. I'm not doing this correctly. Because you can also have pickers in the menu as well, scrolling down here. Now, picker could just be a check mark. A toggle would be on off. A picker would be if you have 7 different selections, you wanna, you know, pick one of them, chocolate, vanilla, or strawberry. We'll scroll down a bit here. Again, they're using a divider to separate the picker. This is what I want to show you. We'll scroll down. You can read the article if you want to learn more, but the palette, yeah, right here. Picker style dot palette. And you can see different flavors. And I just love the way this looks, right? You get this little palette right in the menu so they can easily pick it, right? It's not buried in a submenu. It looks a lot nicer. And then it shows you how you can also use steppers in the menu as well. So again, we all use menus in our app, whether it's macOS, iPad, iPhone, and I bet we're using them to like the bare minimum. So reading these articles will really help you step up your menu game. Next up, we have a bit from the Indie App Devs newsletter. And it's from Teodora of Designerants. She's a good follow on X, constantly sharing all kinds of good screenshots, examples. And in this article, 5 screenshot hacks devs can use to make people stop scrolling. And I'll sum it up here. Basically, use huge text. And she gives an example of like, look, you're trying to read that. Like, it's not gonna stop the scroll. People can't read that. They're really gonna have to focus. Whereas if you just have ginormous text, and it seems like you might be wasting a screenshot just having text in a small image. But if you scroll through the App Store, a lot of the big apps, this is what they do. And what I'm seeing is, you know, the actual app in a phone, in a screen, may only be shown on like 60 to 70% of the screenshots. And a lot of them are just basic images like this that really emphasize what the app does. What is the benefit of downloading this app? So get rid of the small text, start using huge text. And then there is contrasting colors. Like, you really want to stand out. It's kind of the TikTokification of this, right? You want to stop the user from scrolling. They're scrolling through the App Store. You want something big, bright, stands out that makes them stop the scroll and look. And that's what these contrasting colors do. And then I like this one too, the have an artifact. So basically an artifact is, in my mind, another word for visual hierarchy. Have something on the screenshot that immediately jumps out of the eye, that focuses them, that is important. So I think this first screenshot is a good example, right? You're looking at it and then you see the yellow 1 minute. So your eye immediately goes to that. To be honest with you, I don't know if these two on the right are great examples of my eye being drawn right to that, but the yellow 1 minute is a good example. So if you want something to stand out in your screenshot, have it be something that is important, that displays the value of your app and draw the user's eye to it. Again, back to stopping the scroll, use weird images. And you'll see on the App Store, so many of the screenshots are just pictures. They're not even the app. It's kind of the trend nowadays. But again, you're trying to stop the scroll, trying to get their attention. And then lastly is zooming in. Don't be afraid to zoom in on key elements of your app UI. You have a really cool chart, boom, zoom in on it, blow it up, make it big, make that the artifact, make that the focal point. Same thing with widgets. I'm a victim of this, I need to do this. If you have widgets on your app, don't show the whole phone with a widget, boom, zoom in on that widget right there. So these are just some small tips that you can do to improve your App Store screenshots. And if you weren't aware, The text in the App Store screenshots is now used to help discover your app. So screenshots are more important than ever. So take these tips, improve your screenshots, rank higher in the App Store, get more downloads, make tons of money, retire, live a great life. Easy as that, right? How Swift Server Support powers Things Cloud. If you're not familiar with Things, it is a very popular to-do app. Feels like it's been around forever, but this answers the question that has been going on for years with server-side Swift. Is it mature enough? Is it ready for production? Should we use it? I feel like that question has been asked for 5 or 6 years now. And in my opinion, it's been answered for 5 or 6 years now. It is. But here's Things talking about their experience switching their old backend over to server-side Swift. So what Things Cloud did was it synced up the to-do list on all devices, right? Mac, iPhone, Watch, Vision Pro, iPad. It was a syncing engine across all devices. So why did they switch? Well, their legacy service was built on Python 2 and Google App Engines. They said it was stable, but it was starting to be limited. Slow response time, high memory usage drove up the infrastructure cost, and Python's lack of static typing made like changing it risky. It just started to become old and dated. So while they admit a full rewrite is a last resort, but it felt like the only viable path for them. So they explored all the options, Java, Python, Go, C++. However, Swift, which was already a core part of our client apps, stood out for potential and unique benefits. The excellent performance, predictable memory management, expressive type system, and you get to build your backend and your client pretty much in the same language. You get to share models. There's a lot of nice benefits with server-side Swift. And one thing I forgot to point out that this was a big deal is because after 12 years in production, Things Cloud has earned users trust and its reliability. But despite the enduring strength in architecture itself, the technology stack lagged behind. So think about that. You've had something working and earned your users trust for 12 years. The idea of rewriting that whole thing is scary. So I believe that's just a testament to, is server-side Swift production ready? Hell yeah, it is. And they go through and talk about the architecture, which I'm not really super familiar with all the backend stuff. If you're into that, definitely check that out. But let's go to the results here. The results, they saw the average compute cost. So Swift was 3 times cheaper. Again, this is an old legacy system. So it's not like you're comparing the state-of-the-art non-server-side Swift versus server-side Swift. This is comparing it to like an old legacy system, but still they saw tons of gains in compute cost and response time was 4 times faster. They also gave a recent talk at server-side Swift conference diving into this more. So if you are considering server-side Swift for the backend for your product, dive into this, check it out. But again, I feel like the answer of is server-side Swift production ready has been answered for years, but in case you need more evidence, here you go. Moving on, we have Peter Steinberger, just one more prompt, and it's about how he's kind of addicted to agentic coding. And I really felt this article. So we'll scroll down kind of to where we get started here. Yes, you can just do things, but that's the beauty and the problem. Once you realize how powerful these agents are, this realization that you can finally build everything you ever wanted to build, all the ideas and side projects you've been thinking about for years, but never had the time to do, and it doesn't stop. The more you build, the more ideas for projects I get. You feel the FOMO. AI was supposed to save time, yet I work more than ever before. I have more FOMO than ever before. It's like I dedicate pretty much every waking hour to this, and it still doesn't feel enough. And I felt this, even though I'm nowhere near what Peter's doing. He's might be like top of the leaderboards of Claude code credits, but I do feel the FOMO. Like I have ChatGPT Codex and I send my agents off doing work. And when my agents aren't out there working, writing code, it feels like I'm wasting time. Like I feel the FOMO. It feels like I'm like not doing what I should be doing, because this time period in AI, at least to me, it feels fleeting, right? It feels like one of those gold rushes, right? Maybe the dot-com boom, the App Store gold rush, when you can put out the most basic app on the App Store and it'll make tons of money. It feels like a very gold rush time that this time period is going to go away. So I definitely felt the FOMO of when I don't have my agents out there working, I'm like, what am I doing? I'm wasting time. And these agents do kind of feel like a slot machine. So you're getting that dopamine as well, because there's been many times you send an agent out to maybe build a feature or fix something or do it. And then it comes back, it's wrong, it doesn't work. You're like, ah, that sucked, let me try that again, right? You spun the slot machine wheel and you didn't win. And then there's other times you send it out and then it comes back and you're like, holy shit, it nailed that. Or even better, sometimes it's like, yeah, I know how to do that. You go out and do it, and then it comes back with a better implementation than you would have implemented. And you're like, wow, like that's the slot machine. That feeling of sending it out, getting back a better answer than you would have done, that feels like you hit 777s across the slot machine. So between the slot machine aspect of it, the FOMO of feeling like this time period is fleeting and you're not utilizing your agents as much as you possibly could, yes, this can become addicting, and that's what this article is all about. So if that resonated with you, check out this article and let's commiserate with each other. The Agentic FOMO Club. And lastly, I wanted to share the Bitrig app. It says, today we're excited to launch Bitrig. Bitrig builds native Swift apps just by chatting with AI in minutes and with no code required. You can create an app and deploy it directly to TestFlight. And the interesting thing about the people that are making Bitrig is they are former SwiftUI team members at Apple. Here's their video. I won't play the audio, but you can see them. They basically talk to it. Obviously, it's dictating your voice, and it will go out and build your app. So the idea of this might not be to necessarily build the next billion-dollar app, but maybe, I think the examples they used was like, hey, I'm gonna go to the beach, give me an alert when like the sun is too bright so I don't get burned. Maybe simple like one-time use apps where you don't have to go download an app and have an app. You just kind of build it on the fly, it does what you need it to do, and then you discard it. And that's kind of a whole theory about all this AI stuff, is that a lot of those personal one-time use throwaway apps, we're gonna be able to build on the fly, use, and then get rid of. So I don't know if you've tried this out, here's the App Store. I haven't had a chance to try it out, to be honest with you, but here's the App Store listing. Here's what it looks like. I'm very curious. If you've had a chance to try out Bitrig, leave a comment. Let me know how are these apps that it spits out, because you know it does seem too good to be true, but I do believe this is the direction we're heading. That wraps it up for this week's episode of Swift News. We'll see you in the next one.